Amen.
Without further ado, I present and introduce you to our guest speaker this evening, Reverend Jerry Michael Sanders, pastor of Pilgrim Baptist Church. Amen.
Amen. Pastor. You pastor here too?
Baptist
Church, you can have the next week.
Amen.
Don't take them home.
Woo!
I'll be all right. Thank you.
that made it. And we know we can make it because we have made it. We know he can bring us through because he's already brought us through. We know what the Lord can do because we know what the Lord has done. We do give honor to the Spirit of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. To each and every one here assembled, I'm happy to greet you in Jesus' name. To the pastor, Reverend Dr. Glenn B. Wilson, Sr., the pastor of Pilgrim. Amen. And to Minister Thomas, who shares the pulpit, and to other laborers in the gospel ministry and officers of this great church, and all of you who are here gathered tonight, we are truly honored of the Fountain Fellowship that you have been so kind enough to invite us to come and share with you. And I thank you for the warm hospitality that I have seen. I mean, I came here and everyone made me feel like I was supposed to be here. Amen. All right. Met the pastor's sister outside and she guided me to where to park. And then I met the pastor's wife and she had such glowing words. Met the pastor. Everybody's been nice. Amen. You know, because I have gone to some churches that invited me and they got an attitude when I showed up. And I do count it an honor and a privilege. And then to know that I performed a wedding for Minister Thomas and that after 9 years, he's still happy. Sometimes when you perform a wedding, after a while, either the bride or the groom, well, they both look at you with an attitude. Amen. But I am grateful to see how God is using him. Thank God for your pastor, and I thank him for the invitation that he extended to me. And I am truly honored and delighted that down through the years, he has seen something that where he felt I could share with you in this fellowship. I know he's a pastor who takes his calling seriously and the work that God has called him to as the pastor of this church. And I know he's like me. I don't have this anybody in my pulpit. I don't invite anybody to preach. Amen. The pastor has not pastored as long as I have, but one thing I've learned over the years, I've been at Fountain for 30 years, but if I bring in a jackleg, he can mess things up in 30 minutes. Amen. Amen. You can't just let anybody up in the pulpit and turn them loose to preach. Amen. Amen. I see, too, you've got some great preachers coming this week, so I'm doing like John. I'm just preparing the way, and then I'm going to get out the way, so that those who are coming after me can bless you. I want to thank my members for coming here. Here, you got members of Fountain Fellowship. We want to thank this male chorus and musician Brother Horton for being here tonight. Amen. Some of us are still a little sluggish from Easter. You know, church folks have spiritual hangovers after a busy weekend, but we are still glad to be here in this service of worship and in this time of revival. Let us bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we do thank you once again for the privilege of worship. And we know that worship is a privilege. We know that it is an honor to not only be able to enter into your house, but to enter into your presence. Not only is it an honor to call on your name, but it's an honor to worship your name. And it's an honor to know that there's something we can give you that you seek, that you want, and that you desire. And you want our worship. You want our praise. So we thank you for this time that is ours to give you what you seek. But we also ask that during this moment of proclamation, that you, by way of the Holy Spirit, will continue to make your presence known. Let your word go forth with clarity and with power. Hide me behind the cross. Cover me with the blood. Yes. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Yes. Cut loose my stammering tongue, that these your people might hear the living words of a living God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I'm going to ask that we turn our attention tonight to the gospel as recorded by John. The gospel of John chapter 15. The gospel as recorded by John chapter 15. And I want to begin reading at verse number 1. John chapter 15, the 15th chapter of the Gospel of John, beginning at verse number 1. John chapter 15, beginning at verse 1. We hear the Master say, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Ye are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered. And they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. Amen. Just want to talk about abiding and asking. Abiding and asking. Hear me. In the text, we have a secret of prayer, and we have the power of prayer. The text talks about how to harness prayer, and the text guarantees the success of prayer. This word tells us how to do and what to do, how to get God's help, and how to have access to God's power. How to pray with no strain and how to do with no sweat. How to tell God what you want and how to see God give you what you need. This is the secret and the power. This is the source of prayer and this is the surety of prayer. This is how prayer works and this is what prayer does. This is more than naming and claiming. This is more than knocking till the door opens and seeking till you find something. This is beyond asking and receiving. This is more than learning a prayer and reciting a prayer. But this is the secret of prayer and the power of praying. This tells us how to harness prayer and how to succeed in praying. This tells us what to do before we pray and what guarantees success when you pray. Hear me, this is the prelude to prayer, and this is the power of prayer.
Amen.
This is about standing with God. This is about standing with a God who will stand with you.
Amen.
You give God what he wants so God can give you what you seek.
Amen.
You do God's will so God can hear your prayer.
Amen.
You stick with God so God can stand with you.
Amen.
You do what God tells you so God can do what you need. You hang on to God so God can hang out with you. This is the power of prayer. We get what we need if we stay with the one who can provide. We go to the Lord for salvation and we stay with the Lord for power. See, at Calvary, we get saved from our sins. When we tarry in the upper room, we get power over sin. After you get saved by Jesus, you want to stick with Jesus. See, it's not enough to have the Lord save you. You want the Lord to grow you. You want to be planted after you've been lifted. You want him to do something to you after he does something for you. After he raises you up, you want him to fill you up. You want to stay with him so you can seek from him. You want to do his will so he can hear your cry. You want to do what he says so he can answer when you pray. You want to stick with the master so you can request from the Lord.
All right.
You want to be with him so you can receive from him.
Uh-huh.
See, pilgrim, salvation is more than being saved by Jesus. It's also having union with Christ.
Uh-huh.
It's not just what Jesus did on the cross. It's what Christ does in your heart. See, salvation not only keeps me out of hell, salvation is getting hell out of me. A whole lot of folks saved from hell who are yet, hell, y'all know what I'm talking about. They have the salvation, but they don't have the union. They can recite a prayer, but they don't know how to pray. They can quote scripture, but they don't live the word. They good for religious production, but they have no Holy Ghost power. They've been with Jesus, but they don't stick with Christ. It's not enough to come to Jesus. You need to abide with Christ. It's not enough to get something from him. You need to stay with him. After you meet him, you want to dwell with him. You have to live with Christ in order to know Christ. If you meet him, you'll get something. If you stay with him, you'll become something. In one meeting, he can save your soul, but in a lifetime, he can change your life. This is about the power in prayer, in the text. In the text, the Christ who would have us to live for him would have us to live with him. See, it's not enough for us to follow his example. We ought to walk with him on
yes,
the journey.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Not only do we desire to be like him, we desire to be with him. I don't want to stay where the Lord has been. I want to be where the Lord is at. I need to see more than an empty tomb where the Lord laid. I need to see the risen Christ living in my life. I need more than a historical figure. I need a contemporary being. I need more than the word he spoke. I need a Christ who is still speaking. I need more than a Christ who has been. I need a Savior who still is. It's not enough that he died on the cross. I need to know that he's a present help in the time of trouble. It's not enough to believe that he sits at the right hand of God the Father. I need to believe that he walks with me and he talks with me. I need to know that the Jesus who was is the Christ who now is. I need to know that the same Christ who died for me is the same one who lives with me. I need more than his words. I need his presence. See, the religion of Christ is not just about right belief. It's about a real relationship. You have to do more than ascribe to the right doctrine. You have to have an abiding relationship with the right being. It's not enough to exhibit the right behavior. You have to have the right relationship. It's more than a code of ethics. It's knowing Christ as a friend. This thing is more than ritual. This thing is relational. In the text, we hear the master say, if ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. This thing is about abiding and asking. There's something about sticking that helps you with seeking. And no need of abiding, no need of asking if you're not abiding. The master is telling us about the power of prayer and the words to pray. He's telling us we can talk to God and what we need to say when we talk. This is about abiding and asking in the text. Jesus tells us who he is and what we are. He describes his being and our purpose. He tells us what he is and what we are to do. Our doing is connected to his being. What we are about is tied up to what he is. Our doing is connected to his isness. Because he is the vine, I have to be a branch that produces. I cannot be connected to him, the vine, and be a branch that does not produce. I cannot have a relationship with a righteous Savior that does not result in righteous living. I can't be a part of Christ and never be Christ-like. I can't be connected to him and don't produce for him. Because he is the vine, I am the branch, and I will produce. I don't just survive on Christ, I produce for Christ. I'm not just a leech that takes, I'm a branch that gives. I'm not just a consumer, I'm a producer. I don't just come to be saved, I am a server. I don't just come for somebody to meet my needs, I'm here to help somebody. Christ is the vine, I am the branch, and I will produce. Now hear me, pilgrim. Hear me, there are many branches, but there's only one vine.
That's right.
All of us are an individual branch, but we got to be connected to the same vine. It's, help me, Holy Ghost. It's all right for branches to be different as long as branches are connected to the same vine. It's the sameness of the vine that takes care of the difference in the branches. We don't need the same branches. We need the branches connected to the same vine. We don't need everybody the same. We need everybody connected to the same Jesus. We don't have to all be alike. We just have to all be in Jesus. We don't need for folks to be like us. We need for us to be connected to Jesus. Not us being the same branches. It's us being connected to the same vine. There are many branches, but there's only one vine. Please don't confuse the branch with the vine. Don't think being stuck on the branch means you connected to the vine. Don't think that you're being a bug on a leaf means you have a connection with the vine. You can be lead singer on the choir and have no contact with the choir. You can be popular as a preacher and lack Holy Ghost power. You can be an officer in the church and have no relationship with the Almighty. You can be baptized in Jesus' name and the Lord don't even know your name. Don't think being connected to a plant is enough to connect you to the vine. There are some other vines, but Jesus says, I am the true vine. There are some other vines, but I am the true vine. You got some wannabe vines, but I am the true vine. There are some pretend vines, but I am the true vine. There are some fake vines, but I am the true vine. There are some knockoff vines, but I am the true vine. I'm not a vine, I am the vine. I'm not a way, I am the way. I don't produce bread, I am bread. I don't give water, I'm living water. I do more than open the door, I am the door. I am the true vine. Help me, Holy Ghost. Jesus says, I am the true vine. The only thing true is me, and everything not me is not true. Jesus says, I am the true vine. Jesus says, I am the vine. And Jesus says, we are the branches. And Jesus says, the Father is the gardener. The vine produces the branches. The vine produces the branches. The branches produce the fruit, and the gardener takes care of the vine and the branches. Both the vine and the branches are taken care of by the gardener. The gardener is in charge of the vine, and the gardener is in control of the branch. Jesus says, even though I produce the branch, the gardener has final say on all branches. Even though the branch is connected to me, the gardener has control over the branches. Being connected to me does not exempt you from being cultivated by the gardener. And if you connected to me, but you're not producing anything like me, the gardener will disconnect you. Any branch that doesn't bear fruit, the gardener will remove. If you're not fruitful, you will be removed. And here, please hear me, pilgrim. Don't confuse blooming with being fruitful. Producing blossoms, not the same as producing fruit. You can look good and be good for nothing. You can have foliage and lack fruitfulness. You can be attractive and still be worthless. You can sing the rhyme of an angel and still be on your way to hell. You can worship and every pew is full, packed with empty folks. You can't be connected to the vine. You can't just be connected to the vine or stuck on a branch, but you have to be fruitful. The master says, he is the vine. We are the branches, and God is the gardener. Jesus says the gardener gets rid of branches that bear no fruit. The gardener removes branches that are connected but unproductive. The gardener will not tolerate branches that sap strength yet produce nothing. The gardener will not allow branches to be a part of the vine that have no fruit of the vine. Hear me, you can't bear fruit if you're not connected, but you can't stay connected if you're not bearing fruit. Jesus says, my Father, the gardener, is in charge of the branch. Branches that don't bear fruit are branches that are plucked from the vine. Dead branches and fruitless branches are removed from the vine. Folks who say they is, even though God knows that they ain't, are removed from the vine. Those who care more about their rights as members than their duty as disciples are removed from the vine. Those who are weekend saints and part-time members are removed from the vine. Those who rather give God a tip than pay their tip are removed from the vine. Branches that are dead and branches that are fruitless are removed from the vine. God doesn't just add to the church. God subtracts from the church. We don't just need folks coming in. We need some dead branches moving out. We don't just need a big cloud. We need a good truck. We don't just need a lot of folks. We need some real folks. God gets rid of dead branches that don't produce. Help me, Holy Ghost. Look at it. Dead branches are cut off, and producing branches are pruned back. Dead branches are removed for not producing. Fruitful branches are cut back so they can produce even more. Dead branches would go to hell for being non-productive, and fruitful branches can catch hell so they can produce even more. Help me, Holy Ghost. Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches, and God is the garden. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what you will, and it shall be done to you. This is about abiding and asking. This is about being with the Savior and having insight in the Word. This is about being a prayer warrior and a biblical scholar. Jesus is saying, I can be with him if I stick with the Word. I can reach heaven if I learn the book. I need to close my eyes in prayer, and I need to open up the book and study. I got to talk to God, and I got to read the Word of God. I need to feel something, and I need to know something. I ought to have a fire in my bones, and I need to have some knowledge in my head. Right. Jesus says, if you abide in me,
yes,
and my words abide in you. This is about abiding and asking. The abiding helps the asking, and the asking is connected to the abiding. See, this is about knowing and doing. The more you know, the more you do. Brain power affects prayer power. Weak prayers are the result of weak knowledge. To get a handle on prayer, you got to get a handle on the Word. Jesus is saying, if you know his Word, you'll pray the right prayer. Some of us don't just pray bad prayers, we pray useless prayers. It's not just that our prayers are weak, our prayers are wrong. We pray from our wants rather than praying to God according to God's will. We pray in the name of Jesus, but we don't pray in the will of Jesus. Help me, Holy Ghost. See, you got to abide in his Word, and you got to abide in the Lord to get a prayer through to the Lord. See, you need to know the God, you need to know the Lord and the Word. You need a Bible and an encounter. You need to know the book and the author. You need to know what the Lord said, and you need to know the Lord who said it. See, when you know God, that helps you when you don't understand the book. And when you know the book, that helps you when you don't understand God. See, God explains the book, and the book explains God. I go to God to understand the book, and I go to the book to understand God. Help me, Holy Ghost. See, you can't know God and not read the book, and you can't appreciate the book if you don't know God. Jesus says, abide in me.
Yes, sir.
Know me for yourself. Don't just hear about me, but hear from. Don't just know my word, but know my being. Don't just see me as a historical figure, but know me as a contemporary Christ. Don't just say that I was, but be able to declare that I live. Abide in me. Know that I am a right now and a right here God. Know that I'm real and that I'm reality. Don't think you have to seek me. I'm already here with you. Abide in me. Jesus is saying, live life in me. Live knowing I'm in you and you in me. Remember that wherever you go, you in me. Well, remember, whatever you do, I'm in you. Wherever I go, you with me. And wherever you go, I'm with you. You and me, that's a shelter in a time of storm. You and me, that's a walking cane when you start getting old. You and me, that's your rock in a weary land. You and me, you got protection from the world's calamity. You and me, you got a fence all around me. Abide in me. Don't just stand on the promise. Stand with me. Well, Jesus said, if you abide in me,
yes, sir.
But he also says, and my words abide in you. Jesus says you have to do what he says to get what he promised. Knowledge of his word will allow you access to his power. See, it's not enough to have a telephone, but it used to be a time when you need to have a phone book. It's not enough to have a number, Sometimes you need the proper area code. See, prayer is your telephone, and the Bible is your phone book. Prayer is how you get through to heaven, and the Bible tells you how to get God on the line. Some of y'all got the phone, but you're dialing the wrong number. You got a dial phone, but you can't get a connection. You got ritual, but you can't make contact with righteousness. You need to abide in the Christ, and you need the word to abide in you. When you get in Jesus, you need the word to get in you. See, some of us have tried Jesus, but we haven't been taught by Jesus. And we have the burning, but we don't have the learning. We've had a taste of it, but we have never digested him. Jesus says, not only do you need me with you, you need my word in you. The master is saying, I can't do much for you if there's nothing in you. If all you have, help me, Holy Ghost, is the knowledge of the world, I can't give you the secrets of the kingdom. If all you have is common sense, I can't take you where only faith can go. Jesus says, you got to abide with me, and my word has to abide in you. You can't just own a Bible, you got to know the word. Not enough to reference the book, you got to study the script. Not enough to have it with you, you got to have it in you. See, the word that's in you is the word that affects. Folks on the job don't have to see you with a Bible. They ought to see you living the word. The incarnation is not God sending a Bible. The incarnation is the word becoming flesh. Oh, I tell you, if there's something in you, if there's something in you that can kill you, they have to get something in you that can save you. If you swallow some poison, you need to swallow an antidote. You have to get something in you. What's in you is more important than what's around. Shackles in the brain will make you more of a slave than chains around your ankle. The problem with some of us is what's in us. It's not the racism around us. It's the lack of determination within us. Our problem is not just folks don't like us. Our problem is we don't even love ourselves. We need the word in us. Well, I tell you, some of us don't want the word in us. We don't want to feast on the word. We just want to nibble. We don't want the meat of the gospel. We just want a little gravy. We are glutton for everything the world has to offer. But we always on a diet when it comes to the spiritual. But Jesus says, my word has to abide in me. My word has to get on the inside. And hear me, you don't have to understand it, just get it in. You don't have to like it or enjoy it, just take it and digest it. Just let the word get in. Come on now. You may not be able to explain how the body can take protein, carbohydrates, iron, and calcium and use it to strengthen the body. But all you need to do is get some pot roast, some collard greens, some milk, some cornbread. Get it in you and it'll bless you. Well, when the word gets in you, it's working on you even when you don't know that it's working. If the word gets in you, it can't help but bless you. You don't have to understand it. Just eat. It's not necessary to explain it. Just digest it. You don't have to like it. Just swallow it. Get it in you, and God will use it to bless you. Well, let me bring it in. Jesus says, my word has got to get in. Don't let anybody fool. The word of God is a help in prayer. If the word gets in you, it'll help get heaven to move for you. See, prayer is nourished and made strong by the word. Prayer like us cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. See, not only do you have to take in the word, but you have to have a balanced diet. You can't just eat some of it. You got to eat all of it. Some of it's sweet and some of it's bitter. Some of it's tasted and some of it's bland. Some of it's easy to swallow and some of it can choke you. Some of it's gravy and some of it's meat. Some of it will make you shout and some of it will make you cry. But that's all right. Take it all just the same. If you want power in prayer, you got to be devoted to the word. My Bible still says, my people perish for a lack of knowledge. We need knowledge more than we need money. We need something in our head more than we need something for our head. We need to learn finances more than we need to hit the lottery. We need to understand the workings of an engine more than we need to be in a possession of a car. We die from a lack of knowledge. Ignorance is more dangerous than racism. Spiritual Financial illiteracy is worse than poverty. My people perish for a lack of knowledge. We die of AIDS because we lack knowledge. We wasting time in jail due to a lack of knowledge. We got needles in our veins because of a lack of knowledge. Hear me, we lack knowledge and we fear knowledge. We don't know and we're scared to learn. We got young folks bold enough to rob you, but scared of the computer. They got the gall to steal a car, but taking a test will cause them to sweat. They will risk packing a gun, and they will risk a packing a gun, but they're scared to be seen with a book. Ignorance is killing us. I believe we wouldn't live like we do if we had not. I believe we wouldn't rip each other off and do each other in if we had not. If we had not, we would know who we are, and we would know who we are. We would know that our people built the pyramids of Egypt and started a civilization on the Nile. If we had not, we would know that one of us was with Noah on the ark, that we reached Canaan before the children of Israel. If we had not, we would know that our people taught Moses ethics. Our people provided shelter for the baby Jesus. Our people helped the Savior bear the trouble. If we had knowledge, we would celebrate our past, believe in our potential, and work for our future. What we need is knowledge.
Yes.
Jesus says we need the word to abide in us. It's not reading the stars, and it's not reading your tea leaves. It's not your horoscope, and it's not a palm reading. But what you need is the word of the Lord. You need to abide in him, and you need his word to abide in you. If you want peace, get a piece of the word. If you want prosper, if you want to prosper, invest in the word. If you want power, pump up on the word. The psalmist says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The word within, the word written by man and inspired by God. The word, a true record of God, and an infallible guide for man. The word meets the crisis of life with unquestioned success. The word can never be outgrown and it'll never be outdated. There are no problems that the word cannot solve. There are no burdens that the word cannot lighten. There is no trouble that the word does not lessen. There is no doubt that the word does not vanquish. There is no grief that the word cannot console. There is no stain that the word cannot cleanse. The safest pillow for the dying is the word. The greatest spur to the living is the word. To the weak, it provides power. To the strong, it gives more strength. To the tired, it gives renewal. To the lost, it shows the way. To the sinner, it provides a savior. The master says, abide in me, and let my word abide in you. And you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. If you do the abiding, you can do the asking. If you reside with me, you can request from me. If you spend time in my presence, you will have access to my power. If you do the abiding, I will do the blessing. I don't know how you feel about it, but I made up my mind. I want to hold out, and I want to hold on. I want to stick with the master. I want to stick with the word. Come hell or high water, come trial or tribulation, midnight or midday, pain or sorrow, stress or strain, I want to abide with the word. I want to wait on him with the word. I want to stand on his word. I want to hold on to his word. I want to talk his word. I want to live his word. I want to sing his word. I want to praise his word. You can ask what you want and have the assurance that your prayer has been heard and that your prayer will be answered. What a word.
tell you? What did I tell you? A great man of God. We're blessed today, weren't we? We're blessed. The house is blessed today. Thank you, Jesus, for this great man. Thank you, Jesus. I'll ask the deacons to come forward. The deacons come forward, please, at this time. I'm going to ask the deacons to come forward at this time. Pastor Sanders said, abide in me, and I will abide in who? You. That's what he said. If you will abide in me, I will abide in you.